made me new. He made me new. Oh, yes, He made me new. He made me new.
By the blood of the Lamb.
He made me new. He made me new. Oh, He made me new. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face. We're looking to the sky, descending like a cloud. You're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're seeing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Open up the heavens,
open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Say, show us,
show us, show us your glory. Show us your power.
Show us,
yes, Lord.
Show us your glory, Lord.
Say, show us,
say, show us, show us your glory. Show us your power, Lord. Show us your glory.
Show us your glory,
Lord. look to you, my rock, my healer. I trust in you. And sickness can't stay any longer.
Your perfect love is casting out fear. You are the God of all power, and it is your will that my life is here.
Oh, sing it again.
Sickness can't stay any longer. Your perfect love is casting out fear.
Oh,
you are the God of all power, and it is your will that my life is healed.
Say,
sickness can't stay any longer.
Oh,
your perfect love is casting out fear. You are the God of all power, and it is your will that my life is healed.
One more time. Sickness can't stay.
Sickness can't stay any longer. Your perfect love is casting out fear. To you, my rock, my healer, I trust in you.
Sing one more time. I reach my hands
to the heavens. I lift my eyes where my help comes from. I look to my rock, my healer, I trust in you.
I reach my hands
to the heavens. I lift my eyes where my help comes from. I look to you, my trust in you.
Say, healing is here.
Healing is here. Healing is here. Healing is here.
Oh, and I believe.
Oh, come on, sing that chorus.
Freedom is here. Freedom is here. Freedom is here. I believe it.
Well, if you believe it's here, why don't you clap your hands and give God praise and glory in this house?
Oh, come on, you can do better than that. Somebody give him glory. Come on, somebody lift your voice and shout amen in this holy house.
Amen. Amen and amen. Turn around and tell two or three people no better way to start out the new year than in the house of Almighty God on Sunday morning. Amen. Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, Lord.
And you may be seated in the house of the Lord. We are so glad that you've come to worship. We realize that there are a ton of people still out for Christmas break and meeting with families and enjoying their lives, but we are glad that you're here and we're believing God to do great things in your life. Has anybody ever been glad something was over? Have you ever just been glad something was over? And listen, if you've had a year of struggle, if you've had a year of difficulty, if you've had a year of hard times, and how many know those come to all of us? Can you shout amen? The Bible says, man who is born of woman is a few days. And those few days have a way of being filled with trouble. The Bible says it rains on who? Somebody help me. The just and the unjust. It rains on everybody. One sure thing of life is that you are going to get rained on. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's sure you're going to get rained on. Absolutely. Here's one of my favorite verses in all of the Word of God. It's the 43rd chapter of Isaiah's writings. And he says this. He says, fear not, for I am with you. I've redeemed you. I've called you by name. You are mine. Now listen to what he says after he declares ownership of your life. He says, when thou goest through the rivers, I will be with you. When you pass through the waters, they shall not overflow you. When you go through the fire, you shall not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel. So God's promise to you is not that there's not rivers to pass through, waters to cross, or fires to walk through, but that when you're walking through them, I will be with you. And maybe in 2016, you've walked through your share and more than your share of rivers, waters, and fires. He was with you, and the good news is 2016 is over. Somebody clap your hands and shout amen. It's come and gone. It's in the rearview mirror. Now what you have to do is you have to release it. You have to let it go. You have to forget about it. If you had struggles, if you had difficulties, and you bring them with you into a brand new year, they will affect your destiny. Listen, if people have sinned against you and people have wounded you and people have failed you and they've let you down, you need to hear what Jesus did in John 20 and 21. The Bible says he breathed on them and he said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. He said, I give you power to forgive sins. Listen, Jesus gave each one of you the capacity, the wherewithal, the authority, and the power to forgive every sin that anyone commits against you. And I've got news for you. When you forgive people their sins, their failures, their shortcomings in your life, you're really not letting them go. You're letting yourself go. That you're making a decision that instead of getting bitter, you're going to get better and you're going to move forward. Listen, the scripture gives us this admonition this morning, forgetting those things which are behind and pressing on towards the mark of the high calling of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Listen, God has a high calling for you. God has places for you to go, people for you to meet, things for you to do in 2017. And so I want to encourage you, whatever 2016 held, if it was trouble, forget about it. If it was success, don't revel in it. God's got a new day for you, and it's time for you to move forward and become everything that he's created you to be. If it's your desire this morning to move forward in 2017 with faith, with hope, with anticipation, and with expectation, why don't you just give God the best hand of praise? Somebody, come on, somebody. Somebody lift your voice and bless his name. On this first day of 2017, I say now unto him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above everything we could ask, think, or even imagine, be all praise, glory, and honor. I am glad that you've come to worship him with us on this first Sunday morning. Listen, you are in for a treat. We have a young preacher that's getting started in the ministry that's going to minister to you today. Listen, we are honored to have the administrative bishop
of the great state of Mississippi and the 13-year pastor of the South Cleveland Church of God to minister God's word to us. Would you give Bishop Chris Moody a hand and tell him that you're glad, that you're honored that he's come to minister to you today? Listen, he is overwhelmed with his schedule. He has churches that have difficulties. He has churches that need him that are not in difficulty. He is preaching revivals and camp meetings all over this country. And it would have been easy for him to say, man, it's Christmas and I'm home and I just want to kick my feet back and enjoy life. But he didn't hesitate when I asked him if he'd like to preach to us this morning. He said, Brother Lipsy, I can't think of anything I'd rather do than to preach behind that sacred desk at the South Cleveland Church of God. So in just a few moments, he's going to come and minister to you. And I believe that you're going to be blessed by his words today. We want to give you an opportunity to give on this first Sunday of 2017. The scripture says, if you'll give, it will be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, running over, good measure will man give unto your bosom. Listen, this is an opportunity for you to begin tithing. If you've not been a faithful disciple, if you've not been faithful in the art of giving, this is a great time for you to say, I am going to prove God that his word is true. It's the only place where God challenges you to prove him. In the book of Malachi, he says this, will a man rob God? And you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithe and in offerings. You're cursed with a curse, even this whole nation, for you've robbed the Lord. Bring the tithe to the storehouse and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, and see if I will not open unto you the floodgates of heaven and pour out unto you blessings that which there shall not be room enough to receive. Now let me ask you an honest question. How many of you still had room to receive blessings in your life in 2016? If you had room for more blessings, lift your hand. Listen, how many would like to get to a place in 2017 where you literally have no more room? Do you want to get there where God's blessings are just overflowing in your life? If you honor God with the tithe, he is going to lead you to a place of blessing, the likes of which you have never seen before. Ushers, would you come and prepare to give the people an opportunity to give? Now, let me just very quickly ask you to help me with something this morning. I talked with a family this week that brought a need to my attention, and we can't do everything. Every time somebody expresses something, there's no way that we can do everything that needs to be done. But how many know not being able to do everything shouldn't stop you from doing something? Is that right? Not being able to do everything shouldn't stop us from doing something. And someone brought to my attention that at one of the places that we kind of love around South Cleveland, one of the places that we kind of accept as a ministry project of ours in the Blythe-Bower School District, that there's a family who the father has had a long battle with cancer and he lost his life just a few weeks ago. The son has a severe case of autism and has great challenges in his life, leaving a single mom with greater challenges than we could possibly imagine. And she received the letter of eviction on her door last week and said that she had till January the 4th to come up with assistance or she was going to have to be moved. Now listen, I would like us to help them just have a month's relief while they get together with their circle of influence and try to work out plans and purposes. Their rent is only $700. Listen, if God's been good to you, and he's given you the ability to help someone, you'd say, Brother Lipsy, I want to join with you in doing that. I'm going to give the first gift towards that. Don't worry if we get more. We'll put it in the Blythe-Bower Fund and we'll minister to them. If God's been good to you and you can join me in giving towards that, just grab you an envelope or I get you another check and write in there benevolence and we'll get that need taken care of this week and let that family know that South Cleveland loves them and wants God's blessings on them and wants a spirit of relief to attach itself to them this year. Are you getting any sleep in your house? Huh? How's that? Is the baby sleeping? Not the baby's not sleeping at all. Everybody give that baby a hand. That baby's giving it. The baby's here, correct? Carrie, can I hold? Oh, refresh my memory on the name. Jackson. Jackson's got more hair than Stephen. Would you
Look at this little man. Give him a hand. Tell him you're glad he's in the house of the Lord this morning. Listen, we got babies being born all over the place. The Lastorias had their baby this week, beautiful baby Bexley, and we're just excited about what God's doing. And I just wanted to welcome one of our newest church members to the house of the Lord. This boy has never made a dollar, Charlie, he hadn't paid tithes on. I'm telling you right now, he's faithful. He's steady, and he would encourage you to do the same. Father, I thank you so much for Jackson. I thank you for your many blessings in our lives. I thank you for the young families at this church. And God, just this week, I was talking with one of the seniors of this house that expressed concern for the next generation to get them in the house, to create things that would cause them to have a burning desire to be in God's house and in God's fellowship. God, I thank you for the young families of this house. I speak blessings over them. God, I pray that you'd continue to let them have children to be fruitful, and I pray that you'd give them dominion in life. I pray for the young families of South Cleveland, God, that you would let them walk under an open heaven, that you would give them unprecedented favor. And God, I call sons and daughters of this house home this year. I declare that 2017 is going to be a year when the wind of Pentecost blows through this house in a relevant way that causes young couples, young people who grew up in this house, to come home and to connect and to be a part of what you're doing. I thank you for the opportunity to honor you with the tithe, which is wholly under you. It belongs to you. It's not ours. It's yours, God. And today we cheerfully give you the tithe, and I have no doubt that this $700 benevolent need is going to be more than met for this family in Jesus' precious name. And all of God's people said, amen. Worship the Lord in your giving this morning.
All ladies are invited to join together Sunday, January 15th at 5 p.m. in Roberts Hall as they launch the 2017 year for Arise Women. This will be a time of fellowship as they discuss all that will be happening for the ladies of South Cleveland. Our Wednesday night men's discipleship will begin a new study on January 11th at 7 p.m. The study will last 6 weeks and is by Jim Cimbala. When God's Spirit moves, study guides are available. Join us in room 143. Women's Study. The next women's Bible study will begin Wednesday, January 18th in room 121. They will be studying Rhonda Holland's Giants, Grapes, and Grasshoppers. Amplify is a Winterfest designed specifically for middle schoolers, grades 6 through 8. This year's event is February 3rd through the 5th and is right here in our backyard of Chattanooga. For any further questions regarding this event, please see Pastor Josh or David and Tina Privett. You can also check out amplifyjv.com for more information. If you're interested in going, please turn in a $50 deposit as soon as possible.
Hey, they're still giving. Give them some giving music.
Peace, peace, wonderful peace coming down.
Brother Davis? Come here. As you worship with this song, would you stand to your feet with me all over this building? Would all of my deacons come and gather around this saint? Come on. Come here, Brother Moody. Lay your hand on.
Wonderful peace coming down.
Lay your hands on him. Lay your hands on him.
The Father above.
Oh, we prophesy it over your life, Brother Davis. Everyone in this building, sing that again and make it a prayer for Brother Davis this morning.
wonderful peace coming down from the Father.
People, so many times we get to looking around to find a life to emulate. We think of wealth and riches and athletes. Listen, if you want to find a life worth emulating, if you want to find a life worth following, Brother and Sister Davis were married 67 years. 67 years. Now listen, if there's a marriage in this house that's struggling, You can make it. Somebody shout amen. You can make it. I'll never forget one time I went to a 75th wedding anniversary. And I asked the gentleman, what is the secret to 75 years of marriage? He said, preacher, 75 years ago today, my wife and I made a promise to one another that we would never go to sleep mad at one another. And we honored that pledge for 75 years. His wife winked at me, Brother Murray, and said, preacher, don't let him kid you. There were a lot of sleepless nights. Listen, Brother and Sister Davis had struggles. They had difficulties just like the rest of us. But in the midst of those struggles, they looked to the Lord. They looked to the hills from whence cometh their help, and God was their helper. I want to challenge you to keep him in prayer over the next days, weeks, months, and this year. God lays it on your heart. Go by and see him. Take him out and buy him a steak at the church. He likes ribeyes. Just feed him whatever he wants to eat. And as you minister to him, you'll be ministering to God himself. Would you be seated in the house of the Lord this morning? Listen, I'm telling you, I'm excited about hearing the word of the Lord preached this morning. But Brother Moody and I give each other a hard time so many times. But make no mistake about it. I don't have a closer friend walking the face of the earth. He has been with me, and I've been with him for almost a quarter of a century. And we've laughed with one another. We've cried with one another. We've prayed with one another. We've prophesied to one another. And I thank God for the relationship that he's given me with this man who has ministered to this house so wonderfully for more than a decade. And it's my prayer that God continues to anoint him as he leads the great state of Mississippi. And I'm telling you, there's not one thing that God could do through Bishop Chris Moody. There's not one place he could take him, not one accomplishment
that he could provide for him to walk in that would surprise me. There's nothing that God could do in his life that would make me say, I didn't see that coming. I believe God's truly going to grant him the desires of his heart and make all of his plans to succeed. Would you make your 13-year pastor, Bishop Chris Moody, feel welcome as he comes to preach this good news of Jesus to you?
Amen. Would you stand with me today? I want to sing this song together. It is so good to be home. I was actually not planning to be here today. Plans changed when Sister Davis passed away, and I was able to come and be with Brother Davis. I want to say thank you to Pastor Lipsey for allowing me last Sunday to go with him. You know, that's really unique. I don't think you folks realize how unique it is for the former pastor and the pastor to go visit someone together. I don't think we really can wrap our mind around that. There's a lot of times when the former pastor is intimidated by the present pastor or vice versa. And I want to say I appreciate him. We walked in last Sunday morning or Sunday afternoon after church. We went to visit the Davises. And they made us suit up, Brother Davis, and I'm not talking about a coat and tie. Made us put our scruffs on. We walked in, and I didn't really know what to expect, but it thrilled my heart when Sister Davis looked at us, and she looked at me, and she said, "There's my favorite pastor." That was the greatest thing that has ever been told. It was a blessing to walk in and see her loving on the Lord. Pastor Lipsey, I thank you for that moment. Those people are special to me. Somebody said, how did you pastor in Cleveland, Tennessee for 13 years? I had the Davis family. What does that mean? They had a honey hole that I would go to sometimes 3 and 4 times a week with my kids. They have a lake out there. And of an evening, we'd go out and sometimes we'd be out there in the middle of the night and I could hear Grandpa Davis going up and down the driveway praying in the Spirit. I can hear him. I can still hear him today. Pastor Lipsey, you said it right when you said if you want to look to anyone to emulate or to follow, that man is your guy. I love you, Brother Davis. I love you. Love your family. Thank God for you, and thank God for Sister Davis. Today is a brand new year. Not only is it a brand new day, it's a brand new year. There's been a lot of things happen to me this year. I've had a lot of churches talk back to me this year. I had a few like that here every once in a while, but not to this degree. You just walk into churches, and you never know what you're going to walk into. Brother Rayburn's been an overseer. I can tell you right now, I've met some of the meanest people in my life. And then I've also met some of the sweetest people in my life. I've enjoyed the work so far. I know God's been in this because you've broken a record in this church again financially this year. And where the Lord has sent Terry and I, we raised over $250,000 for home missions. We repaired 16 churches. 16 small congregations. We're giving $10,000 apiece. Now I'm going to tell you, that's to those little churches, that's something. Many of them had a total remodel. God is helping us. In the middle of all of that, a flood came into our sister state, Louisiana. We had one ourselves, but this one was even more devastating. Your church partnered as well, but our state totally renovated with the help of South Cleveland as well. If I count what South Cleveland gave, we totally renovated a church for $130,000, and today they're worshiping in that church because of people like you. God is good to his people. I look to my left and see a pioneer, Brother Lindsey Evans. He hasn't been here in a long time, and it's because I haven't been preaching. But he found out I was preaching today, so he decided he'd come. Hallelujah. His overseer is here. He's been in Mississippi more than he's been here because he's been preaching in all of my churches. Every time I look up, Lindsay and Linda's preaching in one of our churches. And I appreciate him so very much. I'm looking for the young man of church. Hallelujah. I'm going to find him a church to pastor where he can just get some concrete in his feet down there. Hallelujah. It is good to be in the Lord's house. Sing this song with us together. Sing, Josh, sing, You Are Holy.
Holy, oh, so holy, You are holy.
Sing that again. Sing it to Him. Sing that to Him today. Sing that to Him today.
Sing to Him. Oh, so holy You are, holy Lord of all.
Listen now, here's what Isaiah said that we're going to talk about.
Woe is me, for I am unclean, for my eyes have seen, they've seen the Holy King, and He cleansed my lips right before my eyes. And the pillar shook as the angels cried. Sing to Him, church, sing now.
You are holy.
He's a holy God.
Exalted high, and the train of His robe, it filled the temple as the angels gathered round.
Have your Bible right now, take it and turn with me to Isaiah chapter number 6. So good to see a colleague, Brian Rayburn, here today. It's good to see you, Brian. Wonderful friend, pastor. God bless you for being here today. Let's read what we sang today. Isaiah 6 and 1 said, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphim, each one had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, and with 2 he covered his feet, and with the 2 he flew. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. The posts of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. So I said, Woe is me, for I'm a man undone, because I'm a man that is unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people with unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." May God add his blessing to his word today, and you can be seated in his presence. Today, as we march into 2017, I want to admonish everyone today and every believer, not only admonish you, but I want to encourage you that there is power in 1 year. I want to encourage you and I want to remind you again that every year can be extremely powerful and life-changing. A year can change one's life. A 1 year can be a transition to which you are no longer the person that you used to be. For in a year that one can be a spark, it can cause a spark that will cause an explosion of hope or success and prosperity. It could serve as a catalyst. This year could serve as a catalyst that would open up doors and windows that no one could shut or close. Why, this year could be the year where powerful things could happen. But it is sad to say that many of us have become so numb to the moving of time that we take for granted and we don't realize and we underestimate the power of 1 year. One of the reasons we often miss the power of a year is because we fail to recognize its potential. Because of the whole changing of a year, it seems such a simple thing with the tick of a clock. We go from 11:59 to 12. With a tick of the clock, a Saturday becomes Sunday, and December 31st becomes January the 1st. And while we have celebrated transition, most things for us have remained the same. Even though yesterday was December 31st, 2016, and today now is January the 1st, 2017, for many of us, our lives have remained the same. For instance, most of us went home last night after wherever you were at. Most of you left that place and you went in the same car that you got in December of 2016. You got in the same automobile and drove it home or drove it to church this morning in 2017. You probably slept in the same bed that you slept in 2016 that you did yesterday or today in 2017. If you're married, I'm taken for granted today that you were with the same woman last night that you are today. Amen. As we look around today, there is power in a year, but it seems as if sometimes we fail to recognize the significance of a year. However, as simple as the change may appear to be, I must still say that we never must underestimate the power of a year. I can tell you that in my life, years have made a significant difference in who I am.
In 1972, I was born. Everybody, how many of you know what year you were born? You remember the year you were born sometimes before you remember the day you were born. I remember the year in which I was born. Now, I can tell you today that I don't know if it was a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday, but I know it was 1972. My life took another radical change in the year of 1990 when my best friend was killed in a car accident, headed up Highway 5 to get on 75 in between Van Alstine and Sherman, Texas, and my life forever changed. He was my best friend in the whole entire world. And then my life took another radical change in 1994 when I was introduced to a man named Lipsy. And my life took another turn. I thought I would never find a friend like I had that was taken from me at 17 years old. I thought I would never find another friend. My life took a drastic change when Terry and I were married in 1994. You can see 1994 was good to me. 1996, our baby boy was born. In 1998, girl number one was born. In 2002, girl number two was born. And we moved from the Alamo State to the Volunteer State. I remember the day we celebrated 100 years right here in Cleveland, Tennessee in 2007 at the T.L. Lowry Ministry Center. This church celebrated 100 years. I can still remember us moving into this beautiful edifice God gave us in February of 2009, almost 8 years ago. God has been good to me. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that when people talk about their lives, they talk in years. They talk about when in 55 I did this, or in 58 I did this. I still remember in 1977 when I was a five-year-old boy giving my life to Jesus. I remember in 1979 as a seven-year-old boy receiving the outpouring of the power of Pentecost from the upper room. I still remember the powerful, significant days in my life. And I believe that the year 2017 holds in store for God's people some of the greatest treasures that we've yet to unpack. Somebody ought to praise Him in this place for that. You see, years have marked changes for all of us. I could play ball in my 30s, but not in my 40s. I could play ball a little better than I used to could play ball in my 30s than in my 40s. I'm not as smart. I almost said dumb, but I think it is dumb sometimes to run up and down a hill like Brother Lipsy. I mean, I just can't see any joy in that. Hallelujah. I see no joy in running 26 miles. That sounds pretty stupid to me. Hallelujah. I mean, he's going to be having hip replacements and knee replacements, and I'm going to be laughing at him saying, "I told you, you big dummy." Hey, I'm telling you, God has been good to this preacher today. I look around this room today, and I can say today, had it not been for the Lord who was on my side, I don't know where I would be today. Oh, I thank Him for the mountains, and I thank Him for the valleys, and I thank Him for the storm that He brought me through, because if I'd never had a problem, I'd never known that God could solve them, and I'd never known what faith in God could do. Oh, but through it all today, I've learned to trust in Jesus. Through it all, I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon His holy word. Never underestimate the power of a year. Ask the pastor's daughter about the power of a year. I'm going to use you, Peyton, because she told me, I hadn't been to church in a few weeks, and I just started laughing. Hallelujah, she said. But I heard my favorite preacher was preaching today, and I came. Hey! I stretched that a little bit. Hallelujah. Listen, this girl, Peyton, I'm going to use you. And I'm just using you as an illustration, so let me, okay? Is it okay? Peyton Lipsy, her dad and I realized we talk every day, almost sometimes 5 and 6 times a day, depending on the kind of day I've had or he has had. I can tell you that he loves his 3 children more than anything in this world. And I can tell you, in his spirit, he was groaning for you and praying for you, Peyton, for your future. And he would say, Pastor, pray with me for my daughter. Pray with me. This move is difficult. Pray with me. And he prays with me and I pray with him. My 3 are just like his. Sometimes they get wayward and they go the wrong direction. But Peyton, listen to me. Your year radically changed. She went from being a Texas A&M Aggie. Oh, glory to God, that makes me want to speak in tongues. She's not an Aggie. Thank you, Jesus. She went from going to Texas A&M to Lee University over the span of a year. She went from not having a good, I'm going to brag on Zach a little bit, I guess. She went from having not a really godly influence in her life that she could spend the rest of her life with to getting married almost overnight. There's power in a year. God can change you this morning regardless of the dirt and the grime that you had in 2016. My mama used to say, don't you track that dirt in this house, boy. Mama, you say, you kick them shoes off. Don't you track that dirt in this house. I'm telling you, I've got a word for somebody this morning. Don't you track that dirt into 2017. God says, leave it at the door and let me be who I say I am. There is power in the course of a year. When I look around here today, there are some things that Isaiah gives us, and I'm going to be out of your way. There are some things that he gives us that are really powerful. I don't think you've ever read this the way I'm going to show it to you today, but when you read things, it goes differently at times. What are some principles we can learn to have a good year in this text? Principle number 1, in order to have a good year, I have to have a deep revelation of who God is. What is the meaning of revelation? It means an unveiling or it means an unfolding. God has chosen through the Word to unveil or to reveal Himself to us. We can know Him through His Word, and while we know Him, there is always more to Him. But without faith, you know that story, but without faith in Hebrews 11 and 6, it is impossible to please Him. For he that comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. The more I diligently seek Him, the more He rewards me by unfolding or revealing Himself to me. The problem with too many in the church is that, and you've heard me say this, you've heard others say this, you saw Tommy Tenney write an entire book on this, but the problem with so many of us in the church is we're seeking the hand of God rather than the face of God. In order for God to reveal Himself to you, it's going to come as a face-to-face encounter with Him. Not a handshake, but it's going to be a face-to-face. My dad or any other old-school person, when you're talking to them, they want you to look them in the eye. They want you to look them in the eye. You can shake their hand, their head down, and they'll say, look me in the eye, son. I want to see your eyes. Listen, God wants a face-to-face encounter with you. There are too many of us. There are too many of us. Listen, this is good right here. There are too many of us who want what He has as opposed to wanting who He is. There are too many of us who are wanting what He has as opposed to wanting Him for who He is. Listen, the problem that we have today is we want what He has, but we very seldom want what He is. We don't want Him to come in and convict us of our sins. Help me, Jesus. I mean, God wants somebody who is into Him. I mean, if you're a young person and you're dating, You don't want somebody that is into what you have. If you're dating someone, or if you're trying to find someone today, you don't need to be looking for people for what they have. but whose they are. Hallelujah. And there's not one of us that likes gold digger people that are just in it because of what you have. They're just in it as long as you stand by their side and tell them all is going to be well. But the moment you become an accountability partner to them, they look at you and say, man, I don't know about this anymore. There are too many gold diggers in the church who are just into relationships with people in the body of Christ for who they have or what they have rather than whose they are and who they serve. I want people who are in tune with God that will call upon the name of the Lord that can move and meet me at the point of my need. Listen, the Second Chronicles says something like this. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro, 2 Chronicles 16:9. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro to show himself on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. Ooh. The word loyal, the King James, I think, probably says perfect, is the Hebrew word shalem, S-H-A-L-E-M. It's also derived from the word shalom. And you all know that shalom means peace, but shalem means completely devoted to. And it's related to the word shalom, which means peace or stillness. So in other words, his eyes go to and fro on the earth to show himself on behalf of those whose heart is completely devoted to and is stilled and stayed upon him. Oh, what would happen if the people of God were completely devoted to him and not them? What would happen if the people of God were completely devoted to him and not them? What would happen if we would do what Isaiah would, or what David would write to us in Psalm 27:8 and said, when thou said, seek my face, my heart said to me, Lord, thy face I will seek. What would happen to us if we would echo the words of the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 55:6 when he said, seek the Lord while he can be found and call ye upon the Lord while he is near. What would happen if we would declare the words of the Lord in Psalm 42? You've all heard it. We used to sing an old song about it. As the deer, as the hart panteth for the water brooks, so my soul panteth after thee, O God. My soul thirsteth for God. My soul thirsteth for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my meat day and night, while they continually say unto me, where is thy God? Matthew 5:6. Declares, and you could all quote it, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. I just want more of him in 2017 and less of me and you. I want more of him and less than church and church people and church gossip. I want more of him and less of people's opinions. We must get more of him. The reason there is such a calamity and a dilemma in the world today is because there is too much of us and not enough of him. There is too much of us and our opinions. There's too much of us and we interpret it this way and we interpret it that way. That's not how God interprets it. That's not what the scripture says to them who believe. We must be the people of the word again. We must be people that get in his closet again. We must be people that will privately get in our closet and shut the door and pray to the Father who is in secret. This morning, I stepped into this sanctuary. There was not a lot of people stirring at that time, so I went. There's power in a year. I used to go to an office in here. I was sitting in the foyer in between the offices and the parking lot in one of those blue chairs back over here. Shouldn't have told some of you you'd be trying those out. I was sitting over there, and about 10:15, I heard this commotion. And I'm talking about a holy commotion. I heard these boys praying. Daddy walked in and said, we having prayer meeting. He's ready to find them. He said, are we having prayer meeting? I said, I don't know if somebody is. Hallelujah. I heard the awfulest commotion. Woo, boy, there's praying. And I could hear Brother Lipsy in a distance saying, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. I know he was as shocked as I was, I'm sure. These boys were praying, I'm telling you. They were praying the paint off the wall. Can I tell you, I used to pray like that when I was a boy. Something got a hold of me and your pastor before we came out here today. I said, I remember being a 20, 25-year-old hungry preacher. And I didn't have nothing better to do than to pray and to seek the face of God. I remember when I didn't have people to tend to and people to put a pacifier in their mouth and satisfy them because I had to go see them. That helped me, Holy Ghost. I remember when I didn't have anything to do except just to call on the name of Jesus. I said, God, you help me this year. I'm going to shut the door to people's opinions. I'm going to shut the door to prophesying Philly. And I'm going to shut the door to singing Sally. And I'm going to hear what thus saith the word of Almighty God. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will endure forever. One old boy said, you can hear a whole lot of things except people praying. Hey, there's too many people in the church saying, what you hearing about so-and-so? What you hearing about this? What you hearing about? Hey, we got enough hearing. We need to hear somebody call on the mighty name of Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I walked into that room and there were three young boys in their early 20s. And they were praising God and they were laying hands on anything that moved and didn't move. I'm talking about books in the library they was praying over. Hallelujah. I wish to God that we'd get some of us older people and older saints again to get a hunger and a thirsting after the things of God again. What would happen if the church would pray? What would happen if the church would pray? Hello. Listen. Isaiah, watch this. He had an encounter with God, a revelation of who God is. Watch what happens. Watch in the year. King Uzziah died. I saw the Lord. Watch that. What was stopping? Something got a hold of me yesterday reading this. On my way home from a ball game. What was stopping Isaiah from knowing to seeing God? What was stopping Isaiah from knowing God to seeing God? Because there's a big difference in knowing and seeing. Hallelujah. What was stopping him? Perhaps it was King Uzziah. For the Bible said, in the year, King Uzziah, there's power in a year, hallelujah. In the year that King Uzziah died, then it says, I saw the Lord, hallelujah. Now my next question is, what is your King Uzziah? Well, what is it or who is it that is keeping you from seeing him? Because he didn't see him until Uzziah died. Help me, Holy Ghost. Maybe, just maybe, Uzziah provided this false sense of security to him. Maybe that Uzziah's greatest had Isaiah thinking that all his needs were met because he was King Uzziah. Maybe Uzziah's military made him feel that he was safe from outside threats. Maybe his financial wizardry made them feel that always they would be provided for and they'd always prosper. Maybe Uzziah became Isaiah's sugar daddy or sugar mama. He was in who he had the hookup with. Now y'all not gonna hear me. Y'all gonna remember I've been in Mississippi. You gotta flow with them. I've been the closest thing that I've been to home in a long time. We have 21 African American churches. Woo! Hallelujah. If I was preaching there today, they wouldn't be looking at me like y'all are. Hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah. Listen, there's too many of us who have Uzziahs in our life that are keeping us from just knowing about God to seeing who God is. Help me, Jesus. I want more of Him. Warning, don't you ever be so enamored with anything that it gets in the way of seeing God. Don't make God kill your king. Let me say that again. Don't you make God kill your king. What is it that is standing in the way of you seeing Him? What is it that's holding you back from being whom God has called you to be? Good to have a good man or a good woman, but if you make him or her king, you're in trouble. It's good to have a good job, but if you make that job your king, you're in trouble. It's good to have good leaders in the church. It's good to have good preachers, but the moment you make us king, we are in trouble. It's good to have good friends. It's good to have good finances. It's good to have nice homes. It's good to have nice cars. It's good to have talented kids who make you travel all over the world and go to AAU and all of these things, sporting events. But I'm going to tell you something. The moment you make them, help me, Holy Ghost. We have king things in our lives, and they have kept us from being about the Father's business. Ooh. Isaiah sees greater. In the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and His train filled the temple. Isaiah said, I saw God in His sovereignty. An earthly king may have died, but the Lord still reigns. Hey, notice he said, in the year that King Uzziah died. Watch what he does. I saw the Lord high and lifted up. He said, even though Uzziah is gone, God is not dead. Hallelujah. Even though King Uzziah is no longer around, my God is still alive and well and seated at the right hand. Hey, God is still on the throne this morning. The throne is the right to rule the world. We do not give God authority over our lives. He has it whether you like it or not. I'm so tired of us getting all bent out of shape over the Democrats and the Republicans. Dear God, I wish we'd just put our big boy britches on and understand that it is God who sits on the throne. Not Trump. Not, it's not Obama. It's not Chelsea's mama. And it's not Trump's drama. It's God who sits upon the throne. It's God who is God all by Himself. It's God whom I'm in love with. It's God who holds the world in the palm of His hand. It's God who makes me to lie down in green pastures. It's God who leads me beside still waters. It's God that restores my soul. I say it's God when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I don't fear no evil, for He is with me, my God and my Savior. I'm telling you today, God is on my side. Hey, Brother Vassal, I was in a meeting the other day with Brother William Golden, our African-American director, and he said, if God is for you, who cares who's against you? Woo! Hallelujah. I got news for y'all. God's on my side. You may root for Alabama. You may root for Clemson. Many of you, your teams have lost, and you root for a conference. You may root for the SEC. You may root for the ACC. But I'm telling you right now, there's one who sits on the throne, who never loses a fight, who never loses anything. He's always been. He's always going to be. And He will come again with 10,000 of His angels. I got to quit. Hallelujah. This year, I'm going to examine myself. Secondly, I'm going to examine myself by God's standards. The New Year's question that I ask you today is, who am I by God's standards? Where do I stand in His presence? Ooh. Who am I in God's standards? I don't care who you are in this world's standards. I want to know, who are you in God's standards? Where do you stand with Him? You won't be asking yourselves these questions when you start living by God's standards. Is it okay if I do this? Is it okay if I do that? Is it okay if I go here? Is it okay if I do this? Is it okay if I attend this? Watch this. If Jesus was standing here, Would you feel comfortable doing it? Wearing it? Drinking it? Smoking it? Saying it? Help me, Holy Ghost. Lying it? Thieving it? Help me, Jesus. Adultering it? Butchering it? Help me, Holy Ghost. Would you feel okay watching what you're watching? Would you feel okay endorsing who you're endorsing? He saw God in His holiness. He saw something of the Lord as Moses described Him in Exodus 15 and 11. Glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, or awesome in His glory. Listen, the vision was of God high and lifted up on His throne. He saw God as the central object of all praise, surrounded by heavenly angelic beings, the seraphim. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one of them had six wings. Watch this. The twain, He covered His face. With twain, He covered His feet. With twain, He did fly. And one cried to another, "Holy, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with His glory." When he sees God as he's never seen Him, then he sees himself. When's the last time you saw Him? When he sees God as he's supposed to see God, then he sees who He is. When is the last time you saw Him? I saw Him this morning. I kid with this guy a lot. He had no idea what that meant to me in that prayer room today. I saw Him today, and I had to repent, for I'm a man that's unclean. Help me, Jesus. I don't care if I'm the Pope of Mississippi Church of God. I don't care if he's the pastor of the best church in the Church of God. God don't give a flying flip about any of that. Did y'all hear what I said? I don't care if you was raised Church of God, sprinkled a Methodist, and dunked on Assembly of God. I don't really care. And God doesn't care. What God wants to know is, when's the last time you saw me? Because when you see me, you're going to see who you are. And you're going to fall on your face. And you're going to cry, "Whoa. Whoa, God. Whoa, whoa, God, I'm unclean." I don't care if you think you're the holiest thing since sliced bread. When you see Him, you're going to fall on your face and you're going to say, "I'm unclean. I am unclean." Oh, God, if ever this nation was unclean, if ever the church was unclean, we say things on social media to one another and then we get really childish and we block one another. How stupid. We must come together. I feel like John the Baptist this morning. And thank God I'm leaving and he has to preach next week. Listen to me, church, here at South Cleveland. We must shut the door again and get in His presence and see who we are again. You're not all this in a bag of chips that these preachers tell you you are. You're not this great champion of the world that just walks around floating in the sky and you never have another problem and it's always going to be sunshine. I got news for you. It's going to rain on the just and the unjust. I got news for you. There's trouble coming your way this year, but greater is He that is in you than he that is in this world. God is on your side this morning. Don't you be dismayed or destroyed. He's alive and well. And finally today, I didn't get to anything. Finally today, if I get to finally, hallelujah. This is the year that I will make myself available to answer the call of God. Not only is this going to be the year of divine revelation, not only is this going to be the year to where I see who I am and I get into His presence again and I shut the door to people around me. Finally, it's going to be the year where I make myself available to answer the call of God. Isaiah saw himself as he had never quite seen Him before.
He did not see them in the way that one sees themselves as they desire their own image in the mirror. No, no. He did not see himself as a good person worthy of God's commendation and the praise of his people. He didn't think to himself, wow, look at me. This morning, I have to confess, when I woke up, I went to the mirror more than once. Before I came in here, I went to the mirror again. Gonna make sure everything's in order. Y'all still with me? There's preachers' worst nightmares. I don't even have to tell you what they are, but I'm telling you right now. You look at your hair, you look at your face, you look at everything, you look at everything that's going on. You want to make sure it's all right. It's as good as it's going to get. Brother Davis told me last Sunday when we went in, he told Pastor Lipsy and I when we went in and Sister Dawn was with us, he said, I hate that she's growing feeble and it looks like she's going to pass away because I'm better looking to her today than I've ever been. Brother Lipsy said, well, yeah, you're a good-looking guy. He said, oh, you don't understand. She's losing her eyesight, and I look better today to her than I've ever looked. Listen, when we see him, when we see him, when we see him, he starts preparing you. Our responsibility is to be available while it is to also be able to get in his presence. Our responsibility is to get into the place where we make ourselves a vessel worthy of his presence to avail itself upon us. How does a clean God, watch this, how does a clean God prepare an unclean person? How does a perfect God place a perfect anointing in an imperfect vessel? And how does a powerful God send out a weak person to take a powerful message to the world? Paul said it like this in 1 Corinthians 16. In 1 Corinthians 1 and 26, excuse me. Paul said it like this. He said, for you see your calling, brothers, how that many of you are wise and you seek after the flesh. Not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God hath chosen the foolish things. God hath chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. What did Paul say in the 2 Corinthians chapter 4? He said, but we have this treasure in these earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and that not of us. The vision was of God. It was a high and a lifted throne. Above it stood the seraphims, and the post of the door moved as the voice of him that cried, and the house filled with smoke, holy, perfect, unpolluted, honorable, worthy, sacred. Isaiah's response, when he sees God as he's never seen him before, he then sees himself. In verse 5, he said, then said I, woe is me. I'm undone. I'm a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of people who are unclean. My eyes, however, have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Woe is me. The Hebrew word for woe is howie. Hallelujah, like Howie Mandel. Howie. It means alas. Or almost, oh no! Whoa, 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 whoa. When he says, whoa, oh no! Oh no! Listen, I don't understand people who claim to be in God's presence and become arrogant and thinking they're better than everybody else and woe is me! Edwin Lipsy, don't you ever get to the place where you have to have 25 bodyguards to get you somewhere. Help me, Jesus. The songwriter said, I can't even walk. I said, I can't even walk. Somebody gonna get a hold of that in a minute. I can't even walk. Without you holding my hand. The first time I came into this house, I came in singing this song right here. I'm about to sing and close. Come to the piano, Josh. I came in singing this song, and I'm going to leave you with this song today. We've got to get in his presence. Hold to to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hope on things eternal. Hold to God's. Oh, talabakasatahaya. I got news for you. Whatever 2016 has had you in bondage to, you need to walk into 2017. I don't care who's done what to you. I don't care who's wronged you, who said bad things about you. It's time to move on in Jesus. You can't traipse into 2017 with what had you in bondage in 2016. Go down one time. Stand with me. Go down. There you go. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hey! Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. I'm going to hold to God. We got a verse to that song. I would like to see it. Sing it again. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Oh, you've got to build your hopes on things. Hold. Listen to this verse right here. They got it on here for us. Now watch. Oh, time is filled with swift transition. Not of earth can be can stand. You've got to build your hopes on things eternal. Somebody hold to God's unchanging hand. Get verse 4 ready. Sing with me now. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. You've got to build your hopes on things. Hold to God's. Watch this right here. When your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, fair and bright the home in glory, your enraptured soul will be. To hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold. You've got to build your hopes. Hold. This morning, if you're here, you've had some things in 2016 that have been your King Uzziah, that have kept you from seeing him. You've got some things in your life, some issues going on. You're ready to quit tracking it everywhere you go. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to get a hold of God's unchanging hand. And I want you to move to this front. And I want you to say to the Lord and to your enemy, the devil, my Uzziah is going to die today. I'm going to see the Lord today. In Jesus' name, if that is you and you need to see him today, step out of your seat right now. Sing it. Hold to God's unchanging hand.
I'm gonna sing it one more time. I want you to come. Oh, I'm gonna hold.